Comrades and friends, a very good morning to all of you. Last week we tried to analyze the importance of public sector and the need to defend these institutions in the interest of economic freedom and the welfare of the people as a whole. I said that CAG studied 443 central public sector undertakings. The actual figure is 434. So though it does not make any material difference, it is necessary to make this correction to keep our records straight. We had decided that we would look into LIC, its functioning, and why the government is so desperate to list the LIC in the stock markets. The government is desperate and it wants the listing of LIC to be completed before the current financial year, and all necessary arrangements are being made. It is expected that the valuation of LIC will be completed in the next few days. The draft prospectus that has to be filed with the SEBI is already under preparations, according to the reports that we get from the newspapers. The government has asked the bankers to the issue to hold discussions with big foreign institutions, and they have identified around 100 such institutions to invite them as anchor investors in the LIC IPO. And recently we also seen that LIC has come out with an advertisement telling the policyholder the intention of the government to issue the LIC shares and the possibility of reservation for that for the policyholder. And they asked the policyholders to open the DMAT accounts in order to participate whenever the LIC IPO comes about. So all these preparations are being made. There is a common understanding that the LIC IPO is only to help the government to raise resources to bridge the gap, the fiscal deficit. But that seems to be a very simple understanding. It is not just raising the resources to bridge the fiscal deficit, but we must understand that the present government, the present ruling party in power, ideologically and politically, is opposed to the very concept of public sector and the welfare state. And therefore, it has decided to dismantle the entire public sector, including the financial institutions. Now, we need to understand three very important factors, developments, before we actually discuss the LIC IPO. Number one, capital, both as finance and as direct investment, has never been so mobile in the entire human history as it is today. The capital has no borders, it has no restrictions, its movements are free across the world, and it is always in search of profits and freedom to come and go as it pleases. Secondly, the Indian capitalists have accumulated massive wealth in the earlier regime when they were protected from foreign competition, when import substitution was the mantra then. Today, with the accumulated capital with them, the Indian capitalists, Indian big business, have also developed global ambitions. And that is the reason we see today increasing investment by big Indian capitalists outside the country. Take Tatas, Birlas, Adanis, Ambanis, and various other big capitalists. They have been investing enormous amounts outside the country. Thirdly, in the last few decades, across the world, we have seen a trend, and we also see the same trend in India, where there is a financialization of the economy. Financialization of the economy means the finance capital has become independent of production processes. It does not have to serve the production to earn the profit. It can earn the profit through speculation. And various instruments have come about, like derivatives, futures, and options, to help or enable the finance capital to indulge in speculative trade to further increase and expand its capital. And in that kind of a situation, financial institutions become very important, and the control of finance becomes very important. LIC produces finance. It mobilizes the small savings of the people, converts into capital, and that capital is invested in infrastructure to help the industrialization of the country. Now that capital, that is small savings which it gets converted into capital, is being eyed by the international finance capital, the domestic big capitalist, and also the players in the financialization of the economy. And that is the reason why in the early, say, 1985, 86, 87, when in the United States of America said that you open up insurance sector, otherwise we are going to impose 301, super 301 on India, sanctions to super 301, Indian capitalists opposed it. But then with the liberalization, and when they felt that they are big enough to become the global players themselves, they wanted the opening up of the insurance sector and ultimately the privatization of the state undertaking, so that they can control the capital for their own expansion and for their own benefits. So this is the background in which there is a trend and a demand that the government must privatize the entire public sector. And the government policy on public sector has very clearly identified that except a few undertakings, they are going to privatize the entire public sector enterprises. Now the government has attacked the financial sector. It wants to privatize the banks, and it wants to list LIC in the stock market. And we have always held the view that LIC IPO is the first step towards privatization, because our own experience of the last two decades suggests that disinvestment is the first step towards privatization. And there is no, other understanding that we can have that LIC IPO also would ultimately lead to the privatization of the life insurance corporation. One may say that the government has given a guarantee that it will hold 51% stake in LIC for all times to come. But the same guarantee was given to the banks, the same guarantee was given to the general insurance, and the government today has gone back on those guarantees, and there is no assurance that the government will not go back from that guarantee even in case of the life insurance corporation. And therefore, in the longer term, the government, the ruling classes in India, as long as the class character of the Indian state remains capitalist, it will pursue the policies that would ultimately lead to the privatization of LIC. Now we argue, the what the government has argued, we have countered it through our campaign, through our circular, that the government says that the wealth that is created by LIC, we want to share it with the policyholders, we want to share it with the ordinary people, forgetting the fact that less than 5% of the Indian people are the retail investors in the stock market. Now, the basic thing is that the big business, the international finance capital, wants to control the savings that LIC is capable of mobilizing through the sale of its policies. We have seen that the government, through an investment of 5 crore, which was in 1956, which was increased to 100 crores in 2011 to meet the requirements of the IRDA regulations, the value of LIC today is being assessed. And finally, when the value is announced, you take it from me, it cannot be less than between 10 lakh to 15 lakh crores of rupees. And it is amazing that on a capital base of 5 crores and 100 crores, we created a value which is worth 10 lakh to 15 lakh crores. Secondly, LIC is a model as to how the public sector must function, must operate. We have protected the interests of the policyholders. We have given adequate returns to the policyholders. At the same time, LIC has also delivered profit to the government. And this is one of the institutions which can be an example as to how a public sector must be efficiently and successfully run. Between 1957 to the last financial year, the cumulative returns which LIC gave as 5% share of the government in the surplus generated by LIC amounts to as much as 28,650 crores. And today you see how valuable LIC is. There is no sector of the economy where LIC's footprint is not present. Every listed company in Indian stock market, to some extent or the other, has the presence of LIC. Secondly, with a policyholder base of 40 crore, individual and group policyholders taken together, it has touched the lives of a vast majority of the Indian people. And the number of households that have been covered by LIC are also enormous. So a large number of households in this country have also been touched by the LIC. And that is the reason why LIC is the most recognizable and the most popular brand in India. Why in India? It is estimated that LIC is the third most important recognizable brand in the world as a whole. We have seen that in the last 64 years, LIC has fulfilled the objectives of nationalization. It has protected the interests of the policyholders. It has created the insurance awareness. It has contributed to the national development. Now, LIC has invested 38 lakh crores in the national economy. And today, nearly 80 to 82% of the LIC investments are in the government securities, both the state and the central. And apart from that, the LIC has direct investments in the infrastructure projects like power, water, irrigation, and roads, railways, etc. And by privatizing LIC, you are making LIC a profit-centric organization like any other private company, rather than an organization which serves the Indian economy, which serves the common people from a position of people's money for people's welfare. It would become people's money for the welfare of a small sections of the shareholders in LIC, and that exactly is the situation that we are fighting against. We say that the weakening of LIC is going to have a lot of repercussions. The weaker sections of the Indian population would suffer, because when the concentration is to earn profit, naturally the attention will also be on allied business, a high sum assured business, rather than meeting the needs of the common people and the weaker sections of the society. Secondly, there will be more concentration on the urban areas to the neglect of the rural areas. Thirdly, the business model of LIC itself may change from selling the traditional savings policy, endowment policy, which also mobilizes resources for infrastructure development. The attention would be shifted to the term policies and the non-participating policies, where funds would not be created for the infrastructure development and for the investment in the social sector. And that exactly is what we are fighting against. Secondly, we feel that it is violative of the Article 38 to 43 of the Indian Constitutions, which come under the directive principles of the Constitution. Though the government may say that directive principles are not adjudicated in the court of law, a number of Supreme Court judgments have held that the directive principles, especially Article 38 to 43, are the soul of Indian Constitution. And by destroying or weakening the Life Insurance Corporation, you are hurting and you are destroying the soul of the Indian Constitution. We want the government to learn the lessons. Don't ever forget that India was saved from the financial crisis of 2007 and 2008 because the public sector, both in insurance and banking, was dominated by the public sector. The financial sector was dominated by the public sector. Look at what happened in the United States of America. 2007-2008, we earlier discussed that the seeds of this crisis were sown by the Reagan administration when it deregularized and liberalized the financial sector. And the problem became more acute when in 1999, the government of United States of America repealed Glass and Steagall Act of 1933, which was brought about by the Roosevelt government to separate commercial banking from the investment banking and to separate banking and the insurance. And today we see a situation that instead of learning those lessons, the Indian government is also allowing the mixing up of commercial banking and the investment banking, and we have seen the disaster that is created for the IDBI bank. And we are seeing that the banks are allowed to become the insurance companies, and all this would ultimately lead to a very great crisis in the future. And therefore, from the All India Insurance Employees Association, we have decided to fight the policies of the government for two reasons. One, that LIC plays a very important role in the freedom of our economy, economic freedom, which we call it all. Secondly, it plays a very important role in enabling the government to take political decisions without submitting themselves to the foreign capital. The thirdly, it mobilizes the resources, and in a country like ours, it is very important that the state must control the savings of the people, because foreign capital can never be a substitute for domestic capital, the domestic savings. And finally, to protect the soul of the Indian Constitution, it is necessary that we defend LIC. The government is bent upon bringing the LIC IPO. Our struggle will not end. We'll continue our struggle. Every inch of the ground, we will fight. we will fight to defend. We have created a great institution and we cannot allow the government so easily to decimate and destroy this great institution. So next week, we'll study the implication of the government policy on the general insurance industry, why the general insurance industry is important, what important role it plays, and why it should be defended. So, till then, take care. Goodbye.